counsel, Mr. Yask.
Thank you, Your Honor. May it please the court. My name is Michael Yask. I am here for the plaintiff appellants. I also have present in the courtroom Michael O'Brien, who is here as well. I guess I want to start by all of this was briefed in 2013, and I must confess when I looked over all of the briefing, I was looking for Glaske and Jenkins and Ivanova, and I saw none of that because this case was actually decided before any of those cases came out, and the briefing schedule was completed before.
Castle?
I think Judge Graber has a question.
I'm sorry, Your Honor.
I have a question concerning the wrongful foreclosure claim.
Yes, sir.
And specifically, it is this. And as you say, this foreclosure occurred in 2011, and all the briefing is quite old. But I have a practical question.
Sure.
The borrowers were in default, and someone had the right to foreclose, even if you're correct that it wasn't the party that did foreclose. And I'm wondering what is, as a practical matter, the potential remedy that your clients could obtain beyond the redoing of some paperwork? What is the practical effect where this property was foreclosed upon many years ago?
Well, I would respond this way. There was a second companion case, and in 2012, Mr. O'Brien's successor in interest, Virgin Properties, obtained a judgment and voided the deed of trust. It was void ab initio. So, in practicality, what would happen if we were reversed and remanded is we would have to go back, and now that it's been determined that the deed of trust is void, that we would prevail, the deed of trust would be expunged. It's already been, and that's already been recorded. And therefore, all of the assignments and ultimately the trustee's deed upon sale would be expunged, and Mr. O'Brien would be placed back in title.
Does that change the fact of default?
I'm sorry, sir?
Does that change the fact that there was a default?
On the note? No, it does not. So the
it
note.
Does change the. I'm sorry, go ahead.
So the note, of course, is an unsecured debt at this point, since the deed of trust was void ab initio. And therefore, they could have, if they had done it within the 4-year statute of limitations, they could have filed a civil suit and gone forward and tried to collect from Jill and the O'Briens were the borrowers, not Jacobson. So the O'Briens would then have a civil lawsuit against them for collection of a debt, and if they lost that, which let us just assume for argument's sake they did, because we all agree they stopped paying at some point, then there would be a judgment against them, and they could file an abstract, and they could try to sell this house, and they could do whatever they wanted to do.
Am I correct factually that the O'Briens did not reimburse the $1.25 million loan proceeds that were paid?
Well, that's correct, and that's one of the things that I wanted to talk about, because one of the big changes in Ivanova, prior to Ivanova, the Jenkins court kind of had that same sort of attitude, which is, hey, you owe money, you didn't pay it back, so what do you care who collects it? One of the cases that came out, Monica Sciarrata versus U.S. Bank National Association, out of the Court of Appeals of California, goes into and really expresses the Ivanova case. And what Ivanova says is, look, you don't owe money to the universe. You don't owe money to whoever collects it. I mean, the law in California at that point was, look, if you owe money to anybody, then anybody should be able to come and collect it. What do you care who's collecting it? Ivanova said, no, if you owe money to Bill and Steve comes to you, that's a harm. If he doesn't have any right to it, if the wrong person is foreclosing, that in itself is a harm. Sciarrata says if you have no equity in the property, it's still harm for the wrong guy to try to come collect. So if there is no deed of trust, if the deed of trust is void, as the court ruled in 2012, it's been recorded in the county recorder's office. They reference it in their brief. We all reference it because it's in our request for judicial notice that was filed in 2013. No collateral attack has been filed. No appeal of that judgment has been taken. No response to that whatsoever. So we now have a valid judgment, 4 years old, holding that this deed of trust is void. Now, that's in this record, because all that happened after all of this was going on. However, we don't need that. What we need is to look at two different things. One is tender. Ivanova says very clearly, as long as you are arguing here that your fundamental argument in your complaint is that it is void, that the document is void and not voidable, then you don't have to tender. That's an exception to the usual tender rule, because anything void, it makes no sense to make you pay $1.25 million to the wrong guy on a void document. That doesn't make any sense.
Counsel, are you familiar with the Gomez versus Countrywide case, California case from 2011?
Yes.
And because in that case, it was very similar to this. The same MERS was allowed to initiate foreclosure, even though it did not hold the note. And I wonder how your case differs from that one, if it does.
Oh, well, first of all, our case is not really related to MERS and the MERS issue.
No, but your argument is that the absence of the note is fatal, and that's why I was asking about that.
Not the note, Your Honor, the deed of trust. The deed of trust is what is void, and it has been determined void by the judgment, the prior judgment of the Contra Costa Superior Court in 2012, not the note. So there's a huge distinction, and this is one that I think that perhaps the court is, I could redirect the court to think this way, is that whether or not you owe somebody money is one question. That has to do with the note. A second question is that note secured by this deed of trust, and does this deed of trust attach to this property, or is it a lien against this property, the title of this property, however you want to phrase it? So it has to do with the security for that loan, which is radically different than is the validity of the note. So there's no question, there's no issue. The note is not at issue in this case. The deed of trust and whether this is a secured lender or an unsecured lender, that's what's at the heart of this case, and that's what Ivanova was really getting at, was, look, if you don't owe this guy money, if you never borrowed any money from Jack and you don't know him from Adam, he can't just come in and collect for Bill, even if you genuinely borrowed money from Bill, you genuinely stopped paying Bill, and Bill might have a wonderful argument against you.
Didn't Aurora, in this case, have the note endorsed in blank? I'm sort of looking for a yes or no. Do you have that in your vocabulary?
No.
The answer is no.
The answer is no.
Okay.
I do not believe they did.
They didn't.
That's correct. I do not believe that they did. We have never seen originals. We've never been, those things have not come up. But again, once the court, the Contra Costa court, made that ruling, this court, frankly, is bound by that ruling, and no matter what this court rules in this particular case, that judgment has its own certain effect and its own certain ramifications.
California law, can someone make a credit bid that's not the holder of the note?
No.
Plain and simple, no.
Plain and simple, no, Your Honor. Absolutely not. You can't just be a stranger and make a credit bid, and you can't to make a credit bid on a notice of default when there is no underlying deed of trust.
That's why I asked you about Gomez. You just answered that you cannot initiate foreclosure without holding the note, but I thought that Gomez said the exact opposite of that.
No, not without holding it.
Maybe I misunderstood your answer to Judge Hawkins's question, but I thought you just said to him that you cannot initiate foreclosure as an agent of the beneficial owner if you do not hold the note. Did you say, yep. Did I misunderstand that?
Maybe I misunderstood your question. I thought that the question was about doing a credit bid. I was answering a question about a credit bid.
Was that what was the question?
Okay, so I was only talking about a credit. Who can make a credit bid? Does that clarify?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
But putting aside your current argument, this was all the spirit of our action.
Yeah,
the deed of trust is void. In the briefs, you made the argument that Aurora didn't have an interest in the note or was not the agent of someone who had an interest in the note.
Right.
Therefore, it was not truly a beneficiary and therefore couldn't foreclose, putting aside the credit bid issue.
Correct.
Well, I'm not quite sure where we are with the result of the spirit court action.
I'm sorry, Your Honor, I don't know what you mean by that. Well, here's what's happened, okay? There was a lawsuit filed challenging that deed of trust. That deed of trust was ruled upon by the Contra Costa Superior Court to be void of an issue. That judgment has become final and is currently recorded and has been recorded since 2012.
Well, then is this case moot? I'm not sure where we... I guess I share Judge Selma's question as to where that leaves us.
Exactly like the property in a total mess without any idea of how to move forward or backward or where we are.
Well, you suggested earlier that the note is still there and they can have the debt on the note.
Statute of limitations is run, so that's correct. But that has nothing to do with this case, so they absolutely could sue on the note and whatever happened would happen. Correct. They're not out any rights as to the note. Now, as I said before in answer, I believe, to Your Honor's question, some honor's question, I don't believe that they ever held the original note, but my belief is irrelevant. They either have or they don't. If they were to walk into court with the note in a timely fashion, in the right way, yeah, they could, of course, they could have gotten a judgment, and maybe they still could. I think the statute's run, but not part of this case.
Down to a little over 2 minutes. You want
to say? Yes, please, Your Honor.
Thank you. Thank you for your argument. Well, they're from Aurora Loan Services now. Mrs. Morris.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the Court. Through this lawsuit, appellants seek not only to invalidate Mr. O'Brien's $1.25 million refinance loan, but also to undo a valid foreclosure of the property. In doing so, appellants rely on two primary allegations. First, that the loan was invalid because the lender direct funding was not incorporated. Second, they argue the foreclosure was invalid because Aurora was not a beneficiary who was permitted to place a credit bid. As the record below shows, both contentions are unsupported by facts and the law. And the district court properly granted summary judgment in favor of Aurora Loan Services and denied appellant's motion for summary judgment. Turning first to appellant's argument that the note was void, at the onset, a borrower who borrows money under California law is not entitled to challenge the loan in the corporate capacity of its lender. That case is JJK Starching Machine and Company. More so, the undisputed evidence in this case establishes that the note and deed of trust were valid. Direct funding was a fictitious name for Bush and Hewitt Holdings, Inc., which was incorporated with the California Secretary of State. California statutory law permits companies or persons to file fictitious names in the county of their principal place of business or in their principal residence, as long as it is on the correct forms, contains the correct information, is published correctly, and is signed by an officer of the company. All of those undisputed evidence shows that Bush and Hewitt Holdings did all of those things. Further, California law also permits a company who has filed a fictitious name to contract under that fictitious name. As opposing counsel mentioned, this case was briefed many years ago, but since then, there have been at least three unpublished cases at the California Court of Appeals that have identified, that have on very similar facts, have found that a company doing business under a fictitious name may contract under that fictitious name. And those are the Aquatech case, which is a 2016 Westlaw 364-8319, Hoons versus Wells Fargo, it's a 2015 case, Westlaw 673-6536, and Vitalusa versus Countrywide Home Loans, also 2015 case, at Westlaw 525-8687. Appellants have identified absolutely no legal basis to find that a company doing business under a fictitious name must identify its full name, such as...
Counsel, could you address the other issue and maybe start with my question to opposing counsel with respect to the wrongful foreclosure claim? If the wrongful foreclosure claim were permitted to go forward, and we can reverse on that, what would be the practical effect of that? What could the plaintiffs obtain, and where would the case stand?
At this point, Your Honor, the practical effect would the case would be remanded, and that we would then proceed to trial on the basis of whether the foreclosure was proper. If they ultimately prevailed, then they would receive money damages equal to the damages as a result of the wrongful foreclosure.
What would those damages, I guess this is maybe too hypothetical, but what would the damages be where somebody had the right to foreclose?
My understanding is that the only damages they would be entitled to would be whatever equity they had in the property. But my understanding is that that was no equity. There's not been any indication that I think the property was definitely in a negative equity situation, so they would be entitled to no damages in this particular situation.
What is the effect, if any, of the subsequent litigation in Contra Costa County that opposing counsel was referring to? Does that make this moot?
Our position is that it does not. That litigation was brought on behalf of a party without standing, Virgin Properties, who received its interest in the property directly from Jacobsen, whose interest was extinguished as of the foreclosure sale. Moreover, that litigation was brought against direct funding. It was a default judgment, and also at that, I don't believe, contrary to opposing counsels, I'm not 100% positive, but I do not believe that judgment has been recorded. My understanding, there was actually a secondary lawsuit on behalf of Virgin Property successor in interest, or purported successor in interest, called CP Equities, and my understanding is the county actually refused to record that judgment on the basis that it believed that the judgment was void, and that this is all also not on the record, but that it actually, CP Equities brought the county, sued the county in order to get them to record the judgment, and I believe the county did prevail in that lawsuit, but again, not 100% sure.
Under California law, can the beneficiary of the deed of trust be someone other than the holder of the loan that the deed of trust secures?
Yes, Your Honor. Under both Gomes, Fontenot, Jenkins, all of those line of cases are very clear that the beneficiary need not be the note holder. Here, contrary to opposing counsel's contention, actually on excerpt of record, page 180, Aurora Loan Services did file a declaration in support of either its motion for summary judgment or opposition to opposing counsel's motion for summary judgment, in which it stated under oath that it was the holder of the promissory note. It held the promissory note, it was endorsed in blank, and that it had been the holder of the promissory note. And therefore, even in this case, Aurora was also the note holder. But as Gomes, Fontenot, Jenkins, and those lines of cases make clear, a beneficiary does not necessarily need to be a note holder. The California courts have routinely upheld Mercer's ability to assign its beneficial interest in a property or in a deed of trust to another.
Are those cases you referred to from the California Court of Appeal?
Yes, Your Honor.
Any of them from the California Supreme Court?
They are not, no, Your Honor. And I would disagree with any contention by opposing counsel that Ivanova changes that landscape in any sort of way. The Ivanova case, which was a California Supreme Court case, dealt predominantly with whether or not an assignment to a securitized trust was void or voidable when that assignment was executed after the closing date of that securitized trust. Those things are not at issue here. There's absolutely no contention that the assignment was void or invalid or anything other than the idea that MERS made the assignment to Aurora. That's the only thing that's been raised in the briefings or down below to find any sort of issue with the promissory note.
It seems to be a principle of California law that you can't separate the note from the deed of trust, that the deed of trust follows the note. You're arguing for a set of facts where the deed of trust is clearly separated from the note, or any pretense of acting as an agent of the holder of the note, just under the naked beneficiary. It seems to be your position, a naked beneficiary can foreclose.
I would argue that under the contract, the way that the contract is drafted is that MERS is named a beneficiary and it has certain beneficial rights and ability to act on behalf of the lender. And Aurora was, at this time, the note holder. It also serviced the loan on behalf of another entity, which is not here, it's just the owner of the loan. And there's, in Raviel is a case that I think opposing counsel cited in his briefs where its courts have held, I think those Ninth Circuit BAP case, where there's a distinction between the owner of a note and the holder of a note, and that here Aurora was the undisputed holder of the note. It was also assigned a beneficial interest by MERS, who was named a beneficiary, and that practice is permitted by California law, and it's not found to have separated the note and the deed of trust. So, the last issue I'd like to discuss is this issue of tender, where appellants make much more references in their reply brief than the previous briefing. And the idea that the appellants had tendered the note, the amount due on the loan, and therefore they had actually made tender. First, unlike the case in Ivanova and other cases that found an exception to the tender requirement in the context of wrongful foreclosure, Mr. O'Brien and Mr. Jacobsen seek to go one step further than simply invalidating a foreclosure. They seek to completely undo the loan itself, not just the deed of trust, but also find that both the note and the deed of trust were invalid. It is undisputed here that Mr. O'Brien and Ms. O'Brien obtained a $1.25 million loan, from which they spent almost $800,000 to pay off it. Almost $900,000 to pay off two lower loans, tax liens, and received $200,000 in cash back. It would be manifestly unjust to allow them to cancel this loan without requiring they pay back that money. It's under the Ivanova context and the Lona context, where there are exceptions to the tender rule, that's explicitly related to foreclosures and undoing a foreclosure, where once the foreclosure is undone, the deed of trust still remains and encumbers the property. To appellant's point that they have already tendered, that's just factually incorrect and unsupported by the record. In order to be effective, a tender must do everything necessary on his part to complete a transaction, and it must be unambiguous, such that a lender only needs to say yes, and they receive the money. Here, O'Brien might have notified Aurora that he had a potential buyer, but no party ever notified Aurora that Mr. Jacobsen had been approved for a loan or that that money was available to Aurora immediately. At best, Jacobsen wrote to Cal Western, the trustee for the foreclosure sale, to dispute Cal Western's interest in the debt several days before the foreclosure sale. Aurora is not obligated to continue the foreclosure sale until possibly an unidentified seller is able, or an unidentified borrower is able to obtain a loan to pay off the amount. No party ever tendered the amount to Aurora, and therefore there's been no tender here. And so unless the court has any further questions, we just ask that this court affirm the lower court's decisions.
I don't see any other questions. Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
Rebuttal. You have a little over 2 minutes. And you don't have to use it all.
I'm sorry?
You have a little over 2 minutes, and you don't have to use it all. But that's up to you.
Oh, wonderful. Then I won't use it all. I will read from the county recorder's office, if I may, turn in your hymnals to the appellate's request for judicial notice. Contra Costa County Recorder Office, Stephen L. Weir, clerk recorder, doc-2012-0235829-00, document title, judgment for plaintiff. Excuse me. Judgment for plaintiff. Good cause appearing, the court declares that the note, I did get the note expunged, I apologize, Your Honor, I forgot that was in there. Good cause appearing, the court declares the note and deed of trust that is the subject of this action is, as against defendant direct funding, a corporation void ab initio as to such defendant, which cannot, after due diligence, be located. So the court has made a ruling. That ruling may be totally false. I recall the Dred Scott decision. I don't know that anybody would stand up today and say that that was a correct decision, and yet there it was, and it remains. And so whether the decision is factually right or factually wrong, legally right or legally wrong, there it is. Aurora's known about it since 2013. NationStar's known about it since 2013. It's recorded in the county recorder's office, and it is as final can be. I understand people don't like default judgments unless it's taken against an individual who just doesn't show up intentionally. They feel that, I can tell you, Aurora and NationStar feel it's some sort of trick. And I can tell you that when other lenders have seen this kind of trick, what they did was run into court immediately that year, in fact, even that same decade, and ask for things to be overturned, and they are. So if there was a problem with this judgment, there were mechanisms, intervention, collateral attack, what have you, that they could have done. That's not part of this. All that we're saying is, Ivanova says if we argued that the deed of trust is void, then tender is not required. And that was the point that I was trying to make. It was, in fact, recorded, and therefore I am out of time.
Thank you.
Well, could I?
Go ahead.
If the deed of trust is void and the note is void vis-a-vis direct,
yes,
and presumably it's privies,
yes,
where are we?
All I can say is if we grant the motion for summary judgment, reverse and grant our motion for summary judgment and deny their motion for summary judgment, we would be exactly where we should be with Mr. O'Brien back in the house, living happily, and he could maybe finish the
roof. Not owing money.
What's that?
And not owing money.
Well, that issue is not before this court.
Okay. All right. Thank you, counsel, for your arguments. The case just argued will be submitted for decision. And we'll turn to the last case on the argument calendar, Sylvia Lopez versus Genevieve Sharama.
Thank you.